The history of Oregon is told in the hidden cemeteries of Washington County. From pioneers to international spies, their stories are buried here. Bilderback, you've written a lot about the history of Washington County. What can you tell me about this pioneer cemetery at the Old Scotch Church?
Well, this isn't one of the older cemeteries. It does contain the headstones of many of the best-known names in Washington County history.
Well, I see Joseph Meek here. Isn't he one of the oldest pioneers? How did he end up here?
Joseph Meek was one of the very oldest pioneers, but in fact, he was not actually buried here originally. He was buried on his donation land claim, but his grave had to be moved when they built Highway 26 north of Hillsborough.
So what was Joseph Meek's role in our history?
Well, Joseph Meek was one of the earliest visitors to Oregon. He came across with the famous expedition of Marcus Whitman, which was not only one of the earliest, but also one of the most treacherous journeys across to Oregon. Joseph Meek was a mountain man from the Rocky Mountains, as were many of the other pioneers who came with him. And when he came to Washington County, he settled here, but he and Marcus Whitman remained close friends throughout their lifetime. In fact, Joseph Meek sent his 10-year-old daughter to live with Marcus Whitman up in Walla Walla, Washington. And as many people know, Marcus Whitman and the people around him were massacred as part of the Indian Wars, including Joseph Meek's young daughter, who was only 10 years old at the time. And that really helped politicize Joseph Meek. And he became one of the 102 people who met in Shampooey down on the Willamette River to establish the provisional government of the territory of Oregon.
How did that play in with the massacre?
Well, Joseph Meek was in many ways the leader of this effort in Shampooey. And when the decision was made to go with the United States, the United States government offered him a number of roles in the government. It didn't hurt that Joe Meek's cousin was the First Lady of the United States, married to President Polk. But President Polk then offered Meek his option of jobs in the new government, and he chose, rather than governor, he chose to become the first marshal of the Oregon Territory. And one of his first acts was to go to Walla Walla to avenge the death of his daughter and his friend Marcus Whitman.
A big cycle.
It was a big cycle. And as you look at the early founders of Washington County, you'll see these connections run all the way through it. For example, Joseph Meek, one of his best friends who also came across with Marcus Whitman, was a man by the name of Al Moran Hill. Al Moran Hill remained a close friend with Marcus Whitman, and actually Marcus Whitman visited Al Moran Hill several times at his farm down near what's now called Laurelwood near Gaston. And Al Moran Hill, in fact, is the namesake of the next cemetery we're going to visit.
Thank you.
So now we're at Hill Cemetery, about 5 miles east of Gaston.
We're on quite a hill. Is that where the name came from?
No, actually the Hill Cemetery came from Elmer Ann Hill, who is also a very important pioneer in Oregon history, came across the plains with Marcus Whitman and Joe Meek. Like the two of them, he was a mountain man, the so-called mountain man, who had been a fur trader in the Rocky Mountains. He came across here, settled just about a quarter of a mile from where we are right now. Marcus Whitman would come and visit with him from time to time. He donated this land for the cemetery. And this is one of the earlier cemeteries. It dates back to 1849, the first grave.
Wow.
And among those buried here is another of the very important mountain men, in addition to Elmer Ann and Joe Meek. And that's William Dowdy, who's buried right over here.
Oh. So Dowdy was a fur trapper, so how did he end up in politics?
Well, actually it was a direct result of his fur trapping. The first of the meetings in Shampooey to establish a government was actually ostensibly held to find ways to eradicate wolves from the area so that the settlers could bring in cattle. And William Dowdy, who also lived just a mile or so from here, happened to be one of the best hunters and trappers in the area. And he was actually assigned at that very first wolf meeting to set up a system of bounties for bounty hunters to kill the wolves. From that first meeting, the settlers also decided that they wanted to eradicate more than wolves from this area. They wanted to eradicate the British.
Sounds like a hidden agenda.
Yeah, I think there was a bit of a hidden agenda. And Dowdy, in the interim, had proved so successful at running the bounty program that as the government formed, although he was only 31, much younger than any of the other founding members of Shampooey, he was elected as one of the first 9 members of the provisional government.
Wow.
And even at the tender age of 31, he was given 3 of the most plum assignments, including the bounty system to eradicate the wolves. He was put on the Ways and Means Committee to figure out the budget, and he was put on the committee to decide land claims. 3 of the most critical elements of any government. He's probably the most famous Oregon pioneer that no one's ever heard of. and in fact, if you go down to Shampooey, and when you go to the memorial for the men who founded the state of Oregon, poor William Dowdy's name is spelled Doherty.
They couldn't even get it right.
They couldn't get it right. And if you'll notice on the headstone, they misspelled government here.
So how did Dowdy do getting rid of all the wolves?
Dowdy was very effective at getting rid of the wolves. So effective, in fact, that before long, the Oregon Territory was awash in cows. And what do cows do? They create milk. So that brings us to the next man on our little cemetery tour here, Peter Duncan McIntosh, who came across the plains in his own way, but he actually came across the plains of Canada much after Dowdy and all the others had already made their journey. He came to the Northwest because he was an expert cheesemaker and he had heard about all these cows and all the lush greenery in Oregon, Washington. So he came down through Washington and ended up in a little place called Tillamook, where he developed the recipe for Tillamook cheddar cheese, which is still used today.
Wow.
Now, you're probably wondering.
Yeah, why is it called
Tillamook cheese? Yes, well, and there's no Gaston cheese in the supermarkets. Well, at the time this was all going on, many towns were vying for dairy supremacy. And one of those towns was Gaston. And the dairy farmers of Gaston finally scraped enough money together that they were able to hire the king of cheese here to come to Gaston. But a number of things happened. About the time he got here to Gaston, the dairy farmers in Portland started manipulating the price of milk and that sort of thing, which made it just impossible for small dairies such as Gaston to survive.
So it was a cutthroat business.
It was a very cutthroat business. And Tillamook had the advantage of being on the other side of the coast range, and there were no good transportation corridors. So they were just isolated enough that they survived. whereas the cheese factory in Gaston didn't.
Wow.
So the only thing we have left of the great cheese industry in Gaston is the foundation of Peter Duncan McIntosh's cheese factory, which is still left, even though the building is gone, because it burned in 1993 in one of the most spectacular fires in recent Washington County history, sending smoke that you could see from all over the county, long after the cheese factory had failed. It was a bus barn for the school district for decades. We have that, we have a couple of small dairy farms, and we have Peter Duncan McIntosh's headstone to remember the dairy industry.
The milk wars killed his factory.
Yeah, he certainly did. But if you think the dairy industry was cutthroat, the next man we're going to explore was an even more cutthroat business, international spying.
Wow, let's go see.
Yeah, let's go see.
Ken, how did a famous international spy come to be buried in this remote area of Cherry Grove?
Well, interestingly, there wouldn't be a Cherry Grove if it weren't for the Lovegren family. Levi and his father, August, were the founders of the community. It was intended to be a utopian community built around a large lumber mill. And as part of the building of the lumber mill in the utopian community, Levi, who was an engineer, was responsible for overseeing the construction of a dam. But the dam, which opened in October of 1913...
For electricity?
It produced electricity. It was also as a log pond for the mill, and it was created as a lake for the children of the utopian community. The problem was that by January of that first winter, the rains had been so heavy that the dam burst, wiping out all the plans for the utopian community with it.
Oh, I bet he felt terrible as a civil engineer.
He gave up civil engineering for the most part at that point, and the timber industry, and instead he became a Baptist missionary.
Mm.
And it was in his role as a Baptist missionary that he really made a name for himself, an international name.
How did he do that?
Well, he, as a missionary, he was sent to China after World War I. And he spent many years in China as a missionary at a time when Americans just didn't go
there.
To China. No. And so he developed about as much knowledge of China as almost any contemporary American. As the hostilities started to build up on the way toward World War II, however, he was recalled by the Baptists from China and came back and lived in Seattle. Then, in a scene that sounds like it's right out of Rambo, after World War II, there were rumors that there were Americans being held POW as prisoners of war in China, in the jungles of China.
So they sent him back?
Well, the government hasn't completely owned up to it, but we do know that the government went to the Baptist Missionary Association and asked if Levi could lead a team of missionaries back into China.
Were they good Rambos?
They were not.
Ah.
They turned out to be pretty inept, and almost immediately they were arrested and thrown in prison themselves.
Oh my gosh.
So they were held, too, in apparently some pretty barbaric conditions. And this created an international scandal.
I bet.
The international press was all over it because we had these people who were labeled as spies, probably were, held in this prison, and the Chinese government wouldn't talk to the Americans. So it finally ended up the Swiss and many others intervened.
He must have gotten out or he wouldn't be here.
He did. Dwight Eisenhower, who was president at the time, took a personal interest in this and really pressed for diplomacy. And the thing that really got the Chinese to loosen up finally was that when Levi's mother, who lived just down the road here in Cherry Grove, became terminally ill, they played on the sympathies of the Chinese, and the Chinese released them so that he could come back to be with his mother.
So it has a happy ending.
It doesn't. On his way back from China, his mother died. So he didn't, in fact, get to see her. on the return. But he did. He went on. He stayed with the Baptist Church. But after all this globe-trotting, being the focus of international intrigue, he actually lived out his life right here in Cherry Grove until 1983.
Joseph Meek, William Dowdy, Peter McIntosh, and Levi Lovegren, all pioneers in their own right, and all with fascinating stories buried here in the hidden cemeteries of Washington County.